an apprentice, rises from indentures free. Strong his arm and keen his senses, he's a pirate now indeed.
He's a lot of friends, friends of his indentures.
2 and 20 now he's rising, and along he's fit to run. When it's revenge on legalizing with the usual rembut.
He's a lot of friends,
absolute detestation. Oh. My beloved friends, for once out of my adventures, I shall feel myself bound, heart and soul, to your extermination.
Poor lad!
Well, Frederick, if you conscientiously feel that it is your duty to destroy us, we cannot blame you for acting on that conviction. Always act in accordance with the dictates of your conscience, my boy, and chance the consequences.
And besides, we can offer you but little temptation to remain with us. We don't seem to make piracy pay. I'm sure I don't know why, but we don't.
I know why. But, alas, I mustn't tell you. It wouldn't be right.
Why not, my boy? It's only... Again? Siri, what time is it?
The time is 11:30.
It is only 11:30, and you are one of us till the clock strikes 12.
True, and until then you are bound to protect our interests.
Hear, hear!
Well, then it is my duty,
as a pirate, to inform you that you are too tender-hearted.
What?
For instance, you make a point of never attacking a weaker party than your own, and when you attack a stronger party, you invariably get thrashed.
There is some truth.
Then again, you make a point of never molesting an orphan.
Well, of course! We are all orphans ourselves and know what it is!
Yes! Yes! But it has gone about. And what are the consequences? Everyone we capture says he is an orphan! The last three ships we put up proved to be met entirely by orphans, so we had to let them go. One would think that Great Britain's mercantile navy was recruited solely from her orphan asylums.
So what?
Which we know is not the case.
Oh. Hang it all, you would have us absolutely merciless.
Here's my difficulty. Until 12 o'clock, I would. How for 12, I wouldn't. Was I ever nervous in some delicate situation?
And Ruth! Your own Ruth, whom you love so well, and who's won her middle-aged way into your boyish heart. What is to become of her?
Oh, he will take you with him.
Well, Ruth, I feel some little difficulty about you. It is true that I admire you very much, but I have been constantly at sea since I was 8 years old, and during that time, yours is the only woman's face I have seen. I think it is a sweet face.
It is. Oh. It is.
I say I think it is. That is my impression. But as I have never had an opportunity of comparing you with other women, it is just possible I may have been mistaken.
True.
What a terrible thing would it be for me to marry this innocent person and then find out that she is, on the whole, plain.
Plain? Oh, Ruth. Oh, no. Ruth is very well indeed.
Yes, there are the remains of a fine woman about Ruth.
Do you really think so? I do. Well then, I will not be so selfish as to take her from you. In consideration for you and justice for her, I will leave her behind.
No.
Frederick, this must not be. We are rough men who lead a rough life. We are not so utterly heartless as to deprive thee of thy love. I think I'm correct in saying there is not one person on this ship who would rob thee of this inestimable treasure for whom the whole world holds dear.
Not one!
Didn't think so. Keep thy love, Frederick. Keep thy love.
You're very good, I'm sure.
Well, it's the top of the tide, and we must be off. Frederick, when your process of extermination begins, please ensure that our deaths are as swift and painless as you can conveniently make them.
I will. By the love I have you, I swear it. Would that you could render this extermination unnecessary by bringing back to civilization?
Oh, no, Frederick.
See, I don't think much of his profession, but when contrasted with his respectability, we are comparatively honest. Oh no, Frederick. I shall live and die. A pirate king.
A wife of 17? You will find me a wife of 1,000.
No, but I will find you a wife of 47. That is quite enough. Ruth, tell me candidly and without reserve, compared with other women, how are you?
I will answer you truthfully, Master. Slight cold, but I'm otherwise quite well.
I'm sorry for your cold, but I was referring rather to your personal appearance. Compared with other women, are you beautiful?
I have been told so, dear master.
But lately...
Ago.
What do you think of yourself?
It is a delicate question to answer, but I think I am a fine woman.
That's your candid opinion?
Yes. I should be deceiving you if I told you otherwise.
Thank you. I believe you, for I'm sure you would not practice on your inexperience. I wish you did the right thing. If you are truly a fine woman, then your age shall be no obstacle to what you do.
Climbing all the rocky mountains, or, skipping brand new lights.
Surely I hear voices. Who has dared to approach on all the inaccessible men? Is it the Coast Guard? No, it does not sound like the Coast Guard.
Confusion! It is the voices of young girls! If you should see them, I am lost!
Violet, marvelous! A bevy of beautiful maidens!
Lost. Lost!
How lovely is the plainest of them! What grace, what delicacy, what refinement! And Ruth. Ruth told me she was beautiful. Oh, false one, you have deceived me.
I have deceived you.
Yes, deceived me. You told me you were fair as gold.
Before these gentle maidens, I dare not show in this alarming costume. No, no, I must remain in close concealment until I can appear in decent clothing.
Thank you.
take off our shoes
and stockings and paddles.
Yes, yes, the very thing.
Stop, ladies, pray.
I had intended not to intrude myself upon your notice in this effective but alarming costume. But under these peculiar circumstances, it is my bounden duty to inform you that your proceedings here will not be unwitnessed.
But who are you, Sir Speak?
I am a pirate.
A pirate? Horror!
Ladies, do not shun me. This evening I renounce my vile profession. And to that end, O pure and perilous maidens, all blushing buds of ever-blooming beauty, I sore at heart, implore your kind assistance.
How pitiful his tale, how rare his beauty.
How pitiful his tale,
Oh.
Yeah! Major General.
Yes, yes, he is a Major General.
Yes, yes, I am a Major General.
Of a modern Major General. I know formation, vegetable, animal, and mineral. I know the kings of England and I quote the fine historical. From Marathon to Waterloo and Arda categorical. I'm very well acquainted too with math and mathematical. I understand equations both the simple and quadratical. About binomial theorem, I'm teeming with a lot of news. Shoes, boobs, shoes. With many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse.
With many cheerful facts about the square of the hypotenuse.
I'm very good at integral and differential calculus. I know the scientific names of beings and immaculate. In short, not just vegetable, animal, and mineral. I am the very model of a modern Major General.
In short, not just vegetable, animal, and mineral. He is the very model of a modern Major General.
I know our mythic history, King Arthur's and their paradox. I ask their heart across exact pretty taste for paradox. I go to analogize all the cries of feeling of gallows. Listen, chronic psychic for peculiarity for Ralph. I can tell him that it's Raphael from Gyarados and Zophanes. I know the croaky chorus from the frogs of Aristophanes. And I can have a few of which I've heard the music dinner for. Dinner for? And whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore.
And whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore.
And whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore.
And whistle all the airs from that infernal nonsense pinafore.
In Babylonian cuneiform and tell you every detail of Gramsci Kempis' uniform. In short, not just vegetable, animal, and mineral. I am the very model of a modern Major General.
In short, not just vegetable, animal, and mineral. He is the very model of a modern Major General.
In fact, when I know what is meant by Babylon and Ravelin, when I can tell at sight a Mauser's rifle from a javelin, when such affairs as sorties and surprises I'm not aware yet, and when I know precisely what is meant by commissariat. When I have learned what progress has been made in modern gunnery. When I know more of tactics than a novice in a nunnery. In short, when I'm a smattering of elemental strategy. You say a better Major General has never strategy.
You say a better Major General has never strategy.
For my military knowledge, though I'm plucky and adventury, has only been brought down to the beginning of the century. But still, in magic, vegetable, animal, and mineral, I am the very model of a modern Major General.
Thank you.
I should like to have some idea of what's going on.
Oh, Papa!
Oh, permit me! I can explain in two words. We propose to marry your daughters.
Dear me!
Against our wills, Papa! Against our wills!
Oh, you mustn't do that. May I ask? This is a picturesque uniform, but I'm not familiar with it. What are you?
We are all single gentlemen.
Aye!
Yes, I gathered that. Anything else?
No, there's nothing else.
They are pirates! The Pirates of Penzance!
The Pirates of Penzance! I mustn't prove that.
All except this gentleman, who was a pirate once, but who is free from his adventures today, and who means to lead a blameless life evermore.
But wait a bit! I object to pirates as sons-in-law.
Well, we object to major generals as fathers-in-law! But we waive our point. We do not press it, we look over it.
Have an idea. And do you mean to say that you would deliberately rob me of these, the sole remaining crops of my old age, and leave me to go through the remainder of my life unprotected, unfriended, and alone?
Well, yes, that is the idea.
Tell me, have you ever known what it is to be an orphan?
Oh, dash it all!
Here we are again.
Oh, no.
I ask you, have you ever known what it is to be an orphan?
Oh, Ben!
Yes, orphan. Have you ever known what it is to be one?
I say, oh, Ben!
Orphan, orphan, orphan!
I don't think we quite understand one another. I ask you, have you ever known what it is to be an orphan? You say orphan. As I understand you, you are merely repeating the word orphan to show that you understand me.
I did not repeat the word orphan.
Indeed, you did.
I only said it once.
True, but you repeated it.
But not orphan.
Stop. I think I see where we are getting confused. When you said orphan, did you mean orphan, someone who has lost their parents, or often, frequently?
Oh, you meant often, as in frequently.
Ah, you said often, frequently.
I only said it once.
Exactly. You said often, frequently, once. Oh, men of dark and dismal fate, forgo your cruel employ. Have pity on my lonely state. I am an orphan boy.
An orphan boy.
An orphan boy.
How sad, an orphan boy.
These children whom you see are all that I can call my own.
Poor fellow.
Take them away from me and I shall be in alone.
Poor fellow!
If pity you can feel, leave me my soul. Remaining joy, see at your feet they kneel. To their heart you cannot steal. Again the sad, sad tale of the lonely. Orphan boy,
poor fellow, see at our feet they kneel.
glory, for they would have taken my daughters over the billowy waters. If I hadn't an elegant diction, induction in innocent fiction, which is not in the same category as telling a regular terrible story.
He's telling a terrible story, just telling a glory. For they would have taken his daughters over the billowy waters. Oh,
So that's...
Why do I sit here? To escape from the pirate's clutches. I describe myself as an orphan, and heaven help me, I am no orphan. I come here to sit before the tombs of my ancestors and implore their pardon for having brought disgrace upon the family escutcheon.
What? You forget, sir. You only bought the property a year ago. The settle on your parochial castle is scarcely dry.
Frederick, in this chapel are ancestors. You cannot deny that. With the estate, I bought the chapel and its contents. I don't know whose ancestors they were, but I know whose ancestors they are, and I shudder to think that I, their descendant by purchase, if I may so describe myself, should have brought disgrace upon what I have no doubt was an unstained escutcheon.
Be comforted. Had you not acted as you did, those reckless men were assured they had called in the nearest clergyman and married their large family on the spot.
I thank you for your proffered solace, but it is unavailing. I assure you, Frederick, such is the anguish and remorse I feel at the abominable falsehood by which I escaped these easily deluded pirates, that I would go this very night to to their simple-minded chief and confess all? Did I not fear that the consequences would be most disastrous to myself? At what time does your expedition march against these scoundrels?
At 11, and by then I hope you have atoned for my involuntary association with that pestilence gorgeous by sweeping them off the face of the earth. And then, dear Mabel, you will be mine.
Yay!
Are your devoted followers at hand?
They are. They only await my orders.
Then, Frederick, let your escort lion-hearted be summoned to receive a general's blessing. Here they depart upon their dread adventure.
Dear sir, they come.
Glory, heroes, go to glory. Glory, dying, come back up.
By the usual ways of 21, I've been alive.
Greatly I like natal days. Yet greatly I like natal days. I am a little boy,
but he is a little boy, but
a paradox, a paradox.
I'm sorry.
matter. What did I tell you?
What?
No, no, I cannot do it. Isn't that just one of your band?
Speak out. I charge you with the same sense of conscientiousness to which we have never yet appealed in vain.
General Stanley.
Yes.
Father of my name.
Yes, yes, yes.
General Stanley escaped from Monopoly. That's, he was an orphan.
He's dead! Oh my God!
Yes, he did. I forgot. It breaks my heart to betray the honored father of the cult that I adore.
Break it.
Not. As your apprentice, I have no alternative.
None.
And it is my duty to tell you that General Stanley.
General Stanley, what?
General Stanley is no more.
He's no.
What? What? What?
General Stanley is not.
Whoa! I ended with the whoa.
Birthday will not be reached by me till 94.
I of A shall be, I'll then return and claim you, I declare it.
It seems so long.
Swear that till then you will be true to me.
Yes, I'll be strong. By all the Stanleys dead and gone, I swear it.
All his love and his truth, and he was with joy of his laughter.
That is not a pleasant way of putting it.
once more with his old associates.
He has acted shamefully.
You speak falsely. You know nothing about it. He has acted nobly.
He has acted nobly.
Dear, as I loved him before, his heroic sacrifice to his sense of duty has endeared him to me tenfold. He has done his duty. I will do mine. Go ye and do yours.
Righto.
This is perplexing. But no matter, our course is clear. We must do our best to capture these pirates alone. It is most distressing to us to be the agents whereby our even fellow creatures are deprived of such a liberty which is so dear to us all. But we should have thought of that before we joined the force.
We should.
It is too late now.
It is.
When a felon's not engaged in his employment, or maturing his felonious little plans, his capacity for innocent enjoyment, is just as great as any honest man's. Our feelings we with difficulty smother, when constabulary duties to be done. I'll take one consideration with another. A policeman's lot is not a happy one.
Constabulary duties to be done, to be done. A policeman's lot is not a happy one.
Silence, dread, a cautious way we
Softly to the river comes the
advantage you can drive. But your proud triumph will not be long lived.
Don't say you're orphans, for we
hold that game. On your allegiance we've a stronger claim. We charge you, ye. We charge you, ye.
Poor love.
Thank you.